Do you think the same thing is applicable to professional players? Or do you think that there is that one separation?
In what way? Well, like for content and pro players?
No, not content necessarily, like actual pro players. Because we just talked about, you know, giving yourself a shot and actually going for it from a content perspective. But if you're a pro player, because I'm sure pro players come to you and like, how can I be a pro player? Give it a shot. But it might not be for you. You might not be good. I know, like, I tried, you know, or not, didn't fucking fool it, but I wouldn't have made it. I don't have my thumbs and my hand, my eyes are not the same as what you were given. You know what I mean?
That's the toughest one for me. A lot of people asking how to, like, be pro in Call of Duty or how I got here or whatever. It's like, I think, first of all, there is a level of, like, talent that you just have or you don't. And the talent can grow from a young age. Like I said, I played video games since I was, like, 5 or 6, playing, like, GoldenEye when I was 8 years old. Like, you know, so I've been playing video games since a young age, and so I'm probably learned how to do it now from being so young playing them. And if you don't have that just like baseline of talent and skill, like it's really tough to overcome because of how selective it is. I mean, there's what, 80 pro players in the franchise league or 60 or whatever it is. So like there's not a lot of people that get put into this thing. And so then like my best advice to like amateur players and stuff is like you have to have that one tournament. Like you got to put in all the time. And like for example, last year that Kleenex kid where he just had like an insane champs. And now he's on Toronto. And so to just have that one tournament where you just show off to everybody that, like, you're really good. You just, like, you know, kind of just, like, let your balls hang a little bit, you know? Yeah. Like, and that's really what, like, making it now is in an esport, and especially in Call of Duty specifically, is you got to be good enough. You got to put in all that time. You got to have a decent team, you know, all that other stuff. And then there's just got to be that one tournament where you just go off and just show everybody what you're about. And then from there, you're just like in and you'll just stay in and you won't ever really fall out unless you do something drastic or your skill falls off or whatever it is. But that's like the best advice. And it's not even the best, like it's not even really good advice, you know, because it's kind of like luck based, but that's the best way I can describe it in Call of Duty. It's like you can make it on a P2P team and an amateur team, and they actually have huge prize pools this year. So like that's actually something to fight for. Is like if you don't make it in the franchise league, there's still a lot of money to play for. And a lot
and
of
you're
like
not
respect.
Competing against the Claysters anymore. Exactly. You're not, competing people your level. Exactly. So the opportunity is there.
The opportunity is there, and then hopefully we'll see how it goes. But like this year, you know, hopefully the top P2P teams, as some of those players start getting, you know, sold to franchise teams, and then there's a way for you to move up, and that precedent is set there. So that's hopefully what it's going to look like. And I mean, I don't...
Who knows? Because, I mean, look, this is the first year that we have subs in the game. How is that going to work, right? Like, how do you pick which point? Like, we have, obviously, generals super, super good at the game, and I think a fucking excellent... He should be a starter
somewhere.
Starting
caliber player, yeah.
But how do you put him in when you have other you know what I'm saying?
Like, on a team like yours, you don't.
Yeah.
Like, you can't really. I mean, and even for a team like us, like, are we going to sub Tommy or Titian? And it's like, maybe if we're up 2-0 in London, we sub Tommy in for the third map just for the London crowd or something. But, like, realistically, Call of Duty's always been centered on your group of guys. And it's going to take a lot of culture breaking to break that down into being seven dudes now, not five guys or four guys or whatever it is. And that's going to be tough. I mean, I'm sure a lot of these other teams like Toronto or, you know, even like the Gorillas might sub in Blast because he's also a starting caliber player.
Yeah.
You know, whatever it is. And I think there's going to be some interesting substitutions, like mid-series S&D type substitutions. But, like, that's so hard to, like, break up the chemistry. And, like, you're playing with four other guys all the time. And then if there's just randomly another voice who doesn't know our strats or, like, who maybe knows them but not, like, the intricacies of them, like, that's going to be tough. And it's going to take a lot of breaking down walls to get to a point where those subs are going to be really useful, in my opinion, at least.
Same. When it first started, like, one of the first things that I talked to General about, I'm like, dude, are you sure you want to do this? Yeah. Because, you know, I don't know how it's going to work. You know what I mean? And I obviously want you to be successful, and I obviously want you to do that. And from my perspective, I'm like, I'm going to pick up a fucking starter as one of the subs because that's what you do. You protect the investment by making sure that you have something to do. And I guess that's the point of the sub. But at what point are you going to be like, all right, Pierce, you're... Or formal, S&D is just not you, dog. Let me put, you know, you can't because it is a new voice in there, right? There are things that get developed as you practice. Obviously, practicing with Umu as much as I do. You got to come play, by the way. I just know where Diesel is going every single time, and I don't have to worry about that. And if you're not there doing your reps every single time, you're never going to know that, right? And more often than not, you're not going to discover some new way of playing. You're going to be... a little bit of a hindrance in that specific scenario because, you know, you're going to rotate a different way that you should have.
Yeah,
you
know, like, I mean? If I get subbed out, say, I just get subbed out for an S&D, and then we lose the S&D, I'm going to freak out because it's like, I got subbed out, I should be starting,
yeah.
I lose. So then the confidence issue comes in where it's like, they think that our sub is better than me at search. So then
if they win.
Yeah, but if they win, then they're like, oh, now they're better with him.
Yeah.
I'm not a starter anymore, so then I'm doubting myself. And yeah. like, so it creates this whole environment where obviously they have that in real sports, you know, and they just deal with that. But they also have decades and decades of cultural coaching to like build them up and like understand, like, you do whatever's best for the team. If the coach thinks that you're sitting on the bench, like, that's best for the team. But like, that's not how Call of Duty is right now. Call of Duty is still very egocentric and everybody's still very egotistical. Yeah. And like, I openly admit I have a huge ego, you know?
Guilty.
It's like, we're the best at what we do. And so of course you gotta have an ego to be the best at what you do. And so, like, when you start messing with that and messing with the camaraderie and the chemistry and the bonding and, like, swapping players in and out, and, like, if it's always the same player getting subbed out, or if you're switching players getting subbed out, then, like, the strategies are changing everything and everybody has to be on top of it. And it's just, like, creates this whole, like, complex, you know, clusterfuck. So it's, like, why even mess with it? Like, why not just do what we know works? These five people, they're going to be the starters unless something very drastic happens and somebody breaks an arm or something, you know?
Yeah.
And that's, like, that's my opinion on it. And hopefully we, like, it grows to a point where we can use substitutions well and we, like, you know, we get S&D specialists or a domination specialist and they are in our scrims every day and know our strats and our callouts and how to play. And it works, and hopefully it gets there, but I think this first year, like, it's going to be tough.
I see it working for a team like Ultra.
Yeah.
Because what can happen there is, and they have a perfect opportunity to set themselves away from the pack by doing this. I'm going to put five players only in S&D, and they're not going to play nothing. They're not going to play fucking domination. They're not going to play nothing else. They're only going to play S&D. These other people are only going to play domination, right? And that is it. They're going to play response, and that is it. They're not going to be bothered with the fucking S&D shit. And now when you have a team that specializes only in one thing and they don't have to worry about other things, then they become a little bit more dangerous because that's all they're fucking
I think that's
doing.
Different. I think that them having a full roster like that sets them apart and they can do something great with it like that. Like, that is different. But when you're talking about, like, one or two subs, like subbing in and out for the other five, but when you have, like, if you can separate it five and five, get five respawn, five S&D, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Like, that could work.
But then that's a brand new format for the league, right? Like, that now you have a domination league and you also have an S&D. Like, there's two different tournaments. Now the prize pool also gets cut, like, all the way between, you know, because who won it, right? S&D wins games.
10 people.
Yeah, right? It's like, holy shit, $10,000 here. If you fucking win. Imagine they don't. You come in third and you guys are like, here's your 150. We're back to PCL, fucking Call of Duty 4.
UMGs.
I'm excited, man, because I don't think that... year one is obviously going to be a learning experience for everybody, from the league to us to the players to the fans. Like, everybody's going to have to get readjusted to something brand new. And I think that... The excitement level there is building. I think that the excitement level as to whether or not it's gonna work. The fucking haters out there who are just waiting in the fucking wings to see, like, all right, how can I get in here and talk shit about how much money they spent on this thing and, you know, the viewership, for example, on
300 million.
It's like, oh shit, fuck them, ha ha ha. Like, you know, there is gonna be there, but, you know, I think that that we have smart people involved. We have people who have been here with a lot of history in Hasbro, and somebody like me, and, you know, OD and all these other people that are in there. But it is going to be, above anything else, I think that we should be proud of the fact that we got to a point to where individual people, individual entities are willing to put up $25 million.
Yeah, we built this.
On this thing.
Yeah,
and
we built
fucking
it.
Did, right? Like, it above anything else, no matter what anybody says, we built something so good and so popular that people are willing to put money behind it. And nothing speaks louder than that, you know? Because it's one thing is to put $100,000 into one thing, but to put $25 million into something.
$1 million.
Yeah, that's a lot of cheese. Is that you or me?
That me?
Yeah.
You?
So in that regard,